Our next speaker is the child of a composer and a printmaker, the granddaughter of historians, and the great-granddaughter of a leading investment banker. Her groundbreaking work as an investigative journalist and author blends all of these professions, the art and craft of writing, the historian's attentiveness to telling detail, and the banker's deep understanding of business and finance. She began her career as a stringer for Time magazine, then worked as a local reporter for newspapers in Vermont and Washington, D.C., until she was hired by the Wall Street Journal as a White House correspondent, the first woman to hold that position. In the mid-1980s, she became a war and foreign correspondent, covering the attacks on U.S. and French soldiers in Beirut, the Persian Gulf War, and the fall of the Berlin Wall. Since 1995, she has been a staff writer at The New Yorker. Her most recent books, both based on influential magazine articles, have examined potential threats to long-standing American ideals. In The Dark Side, she describes how federal decision-making in the wake of the attacks of September 11, 2001, led to changes in American policies on surveillance and torture. In Dark Money, she details the effects of unrestrained campaign contributions on American democracy. Both books were nominated for the National Book Critics Circle Award, as well as the Pulitzer Prize for Journalism. For these and other contributions, she has also received the John Chancellor Award and the George Polk Award for magazine reporting, among dozens of honors. Please join me in welcoming the speaker for Class 4, staff writer for The New Yorker, Jane Mayer.
Thank you so much. I was going to start by saying, of course, that I'm truly honored to be here, but I'm more than honored now that I've met the other people in this group and in this room. I am completely bowled over to be here. So thank you so much for welcoming me into this academy and into your midst. And thank you so much for picking me to speak for this group. My introduction to the academy's president, Dr. Jonathan Fanton, actually began quite some time ago. Approximately 40 years ago, I had the pleasure of being taught in a small undergraduate seminar at Yale University by Professor Fanton. The seminar was quite specialized and unusual. Its focus was to examine in a rigorous way how and why several momentous decisions in American history were made and assess whether those decisions had been wise. My particular focus was on how America decided to drop the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki on August 6th and 9th, 1945. All these years later, I can no longer remember what my own inexpert undergraduate assessment was as to whether mankind's first and hopefully last use of atomic weapons was justified. But what I do remember and have carried with me throughout the rest of my life is my introduction to the timeless methodology of scholarship, which included approaching the subject with an open mind, searching relentlessly like an obsessed amateur sleuth for every available scrap of evidence, including reading the personal diary of Henry Louis Stimson, President Truman's Secretary of War, despite his admonition that gentlemen do not read each other's mail, let alone their diaries. We pored over every relevant document we could find and all manner of primary and secondary sources. We grappled with gaps and contradictions, formed hypotheses, and argued and tested them on each other, synthesized each other's critical thinking, and finally arrived at what Carl Bernstein, one of the best investigative journalists of our era, calls the best obtainable version of the truth. Like Dean Gerken, I think, and probably many of us, we all have an allergy to claiming that we have the truth, but we do aim for the best obtainable version. This has basically been the same evidence-based process I've tried to employ in pursuit of the truth as a journalist ever since. And it is, I would guess, the same methodology that most of you in both the humanities and the sciences employ in your work every day. It's the methodology that we've inherited from the Enlightenment, passed down through generations, and that has contributed to all manner of breakthrough and progress in human history. But unfortunately, it's an approach to knowledge that I fear is under political assault today in both the humanities and the sciences. It may seem a stretch to lump these two disciplines in together. In 1959, C.P. Snow famously gave his Reed lecture about the vast chasm of understanding that divided the two cultures of science and humanities. Today, though, I would argue that they are less divided than united in the pursuit of fact-based truth against a common threat, which, for lack of a better phrase, was best described by Kellyanne Conway, the counselor to President Donald Trump, as the production of alternative facts. You may remember that at the time that Conway uttered that phrase, she was arguing that despite demonstrable photographic proof that Trump's inaugural crowd was larger than that of his predecessor, because the president and his dutiful press secretary had said so. Although the dispute at hand was small and petty, the skirmish represented a much bigger and more prophetic clash, because as our fellow member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and my longtime friend Jill Abramson succinctly put it, alternative facts are lies. The fib about the size of the inaugural crowd was only the start. There have been many more and much worse ones from the current administration. The New York Times has kept a running tally that lengthens almost every day, and fact-checking has become a cottage industry, one of the few growth areas, perhaps, in the journalism field. Moreover, it's not just our current crop of political leaders at home who are waging this battle. Similar attacks have been launched on the truth and those who will tell it by regimes around the world. At home, of course, these attacks have included an effort to undermine the credibility of the independent mainstream news media as fake news and those who write it as enemies of the American people. But the targets range far beyond mere journalists. All manner of independent, fact-based research has come under attack, ranging from the economic analyses of the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office to research done by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Among the most worrisome of these attacks, actually, have been those on the scientific community in general and on the science of climate change in particular, which President Trump memorably denounced during the 2016 campaign as a hoax perpetrated by the Chinese. Falsehoods uttered by politicians are, of course, nothing new. What is new, however, is the amplification of these lies by new forms of social media. Overtly partisan, frequently false, and often viciously personal attacks are now spread virally and unfiltered by countless waves of trolls, bots, phony think tank bloggers, junk scientists, and even for hire opposition researchers who literally stalk and track opponents with video cameras in search of compromising material that they can post online, as happened this year to the environmental activist Bill McKibben. It's apparently apocryphal, maybe an early form of fake news, that Mark Twain ever said that lies go halfway around the world before the truth pulls its boots on. But whatever the derivation, today a lie can spread not just halfway around the world, but entirely around the globe in minutes, and often the truth stands almost no chance of ever catching up. As a result, large swaths of the population are being purposefully and constantly misled. Social media, especially Facebook, can circulate false information to 2 billion people each day. We now know that virally spread fake news helped defeat Hillary Clinton in our last presidential election, an unprecedented infection of our democracy. And any crackpot organization now can use the same tools to distribute fake information to so-called like-minded people. The careful research of scholars and scrupulous investigative work of journalists can be overpowered by a handful of keyboard clicks. A technology that holds the great promise of connecting people also has great destructive power to misinform and divide them. Humanity has never before had an instant information distribution technology of such force. It's been compared to the seismic impact of Gutenberg. Our political system is reeling from the blow. Charlie Sykes, the former right-wing radio talk show host, has described the fallout well. He said, the cumulative effect of the attacks on fact-based media has been to delegitimize those outlets and essentially destroy our immunity to false information. He added, all administrations lie, but what we are seeing here is an attack on credibility itself. It seems unthinkable as we're celebrating the incredible achievements of this year's Nobel Science laureates that not just the news media, but whole branches of science could also be under attack, but sadly they are. As Paul Krugman, the Nobel Prize-winning economist and liberal New York Times columnist put it, in the Trump era, we are ruled by people who are completely alienated, not just from climate science, but from the scientific idea itself. The notion that objective assessment of evidence is the way to understand the world. He called this willful ignorance deeply frightening, and he worried that it may end up, quote, destroying civilization. At an upbeat occasion, such as the one here today, I don't want to end on such an alarming note. So instead, I'll leave you with a thought, a kind of inchoate action plan at this worrisome moment, derived from my own experience in these culture wars. In 2010, after the New Yorker published a long and carefully researched investigative report by me on the outsized political influence exerted by two billionaire brothers, Charles and David Koch, they were unable to identify any errors, but nonetheless, they hired a private investigator to dig up dirt on me personally in hopes of undermining my credibility. It was, in other words, a page out of the current playbook that we are seeing all too often. If anyone had believed their attack, it would have been professionally devastating. But instead, what happened was that several colleagues of mine jumped into the fray and publicly defended my work and my integrity. They did so quickly and generously, even though this wasn't their fight. But they did it, I think, partly because they sensed that this is all of our fight. So I hope that all of you will keep doing and honoring each other's astonishingly fine work, and that when honest, evidence-based truth or those who tell it are attacked, you too will jump into the fray, speak up, and have each other's backs, because whether we are in the humanities, the arts, or the sciences, this is actually all of our fight. Thank you.